Now, what are we seeing in open banking? I mean, this is a very rapidly changing landscape, but there are a few trends that we've seen thus far in the open banking world. One of the trends we've seen is that there's continued growth in things like real-time payment initiatives. So initiatives like FedNow and other real-time payment initiatives, these things are really starting to take off, and we're seeing more and more banks and more financial institutions really get focused on the benefits of being able to implement real-time payment initiatives. The second thing we've seen is really just an exponential growth in the number of open banking API calls. So, for instance, it's particularly true in Europe, where we're seeing massive growth, 15, 20% compound growth month over month in open banking API calls. We're also seeing a very similar situation in the US with open banking standards like the Financial Data Exchange or FTX. So while the volumes are still relatively small, when you look at the overall number of financial services transactions that are done every day, they're growing exponentially. So transactions that are adhering to these open banking standards are really starting to take off, and the growth rate seems to continue unabated. The third thing we've seen, though, is that reliability, scalability, and security are just the foundational cornerstones of being able to do these transactions. And what's interesting is we've seen a lot of banks out there that have been able to put up some relatively scalable, secure, open banking APIs, but they're not particularly reliable. Or if they are particularly reliable, they run into a lot of latency problems in terms of round-trip transaction times. So those are really table stakes. If you can't do it reliably, scalably, and securely, then you probably shouldn't be playing in this arena. And in a similar note, we're also seeing a huge trend towards fintechs and aggregators. And many financial institutions are viewing these fintechs, and a lot of them are startups. A lot of them have been around for a few years. They're viewing them as both a threat and an opportunity. They're a threat in the sense that there's the potential to get disintermediated from their customers, but there's also an opportunity in the sense that they can open up a much wide variety of consumers to the goods and services that these financial institutions provide. So it's a bit of a double-edged sword when you look at fintechs and aggregators. But one thing we have seen is that a lot of the aggregators that are out there and some of the fintechs, they started out by really going out and screen scraping the websites of bank accounts. So if you gave them your credentials to your bank account, and many different bank accounts that you have or financial institution accounts, they could pull back all of that data. But the way they did it was literally going out and screen scraping the login process and then pulling the data down. So not a terribly efficient way of doing things, but we've talked to customers that said, 40 to 50% of all their web traffic is simply screen scrapers running from fintechs and aggregators. So there has to be a better way of doing that. And then finally, we've seen that the open banking and real-time payment landscapes, they're just changing so quickly. They're growing, as we talked about, but there's also a tremendous amount of change happening. Specifications are changing, the landscape's changing, the economics of doing it is changing, the players are changing within the industry. So there's a tremendous amount of change, and that really implies the need for a lot of flexibility and adaptability.